Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Today is the fifth Sunday after Pentecost. Welcome also to those joining us online this morning. Just a few brief announcements before we worship together. It is July now, and Christmas in July is coming up. Sunday, July 23rd, we'll conclude our collection of winter items for local charities, and our worship service will have a little bit of a Christmas touch that morning, so please join us for worship that day. The Attic Angel Sale collection is underway. Our sale will be September 14th and 15th, but in the meantime, we need your treasures brought in so we can have the sale. Setup is also underway. If you have any questions, please call Noreen or Jennifer. Their phone numbers are printed in the announcements. If you're interested in Southeast Michigan Synod Day at Comerica Park, that game is August 25th. The deadline to sign up for tickets is 2 weeks from today, July 16th. In our prayer list this morning, we've been asked to add Anthony Rickle, so please keep him in your prayers. Also this morning, in our prayers of intercession, one of the petitions will be for those newly ordained and newly installed. We are praying for my wife, Pastor Joyce Partica-Stibe. She started a new call 3 weeks ago, but she was 3 months ago, I should say. Her installation was Wednesday, and so we celebrate that as she and the congregation of Spirit of Grace move forward together. This morning, Joanne Bodani wants to thank all of you who sent birthday cards. She had a birthday yesterday, so happy birthday again, Joanne. But she also wants to thank anyone who sent her a card in celebration of that day. And finally, happy 4th of July this week. As you travel, please safe travel, or as you celebrate in any way, please be safe and enjoy the holiday and the week ahead. I invite you now to stand as you're able. We begin worship this morning with confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your holy name.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
Thank you.
pray together. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated, and our children are here this morning are invited to come up for a message. That show up in yards and fields along the roads. So this morning I want to think about, have you ever seen anything on a clover, like a living creature? Ever seen any living creatures on clovers? Like what? Bugs? Any bugs in particular? Bees, yeah, so bees sometimes go on the clover, right? Do we know why the bees go to the clover? Exactly, so the bees come to the clover and they pollinate the clover. It helps the clover grow and make seed so it can grow more clover. And it helps the bee too, right? Because the bee consumes the nectar, right? And so these little clovers and those little bees, they need each other, right? They help each other out, right? Do we get to see all of the bees that go on all of the clover? No, so even right now there's probably bees out there right now on some of the clover and they're doing their thing. And we don't even see it happen, do we? But it's a little and very important thing that happens when the bee lands on the clover. This morning's gospel is about little things. We're going to hear Jesus talking to his disciples and including people. So remember, the disciples are going out into the world. The disciples are going to do the things Jesus did, helping people, serving people. And at the end, Jesus says that even giving a cup of water important. Now, a cup of water can be small, right? A cup of water can be big. But we might not think a cup of water is that important, right? But it can be important. And Jesus reminds the people that if they welcome the disciples and give them a cup of water, even those people and that action of giving the water, that's important too. Because they might think, sometimes we hear about the disciples, they sound like pretty amazing people, don't they? They went out by themselves and did all these things that Jesus did, and we might think, wow, I could never do that. But there are things that we might do, small things, even a simple thank you or a birthday card, or just giving someone the opportunity to listen or a smile. All of these small things, we might think that's not important. But Jesus is going to remind us this morning that those small things also are important to sharing his love with others. So we can remember that and be encouraged by that. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads to pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for flowers and bees and all of your wonderful creation and all of the small things that happen that we don't even notice but are so important. Thank you also that our small actions that we might feel are not important turn out to be so important as we share your love even in small ways. Pray this all in your precious name. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
First reading is from Jeremiah, the 28th chapter. The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priest and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read responsively Psalm 89. Your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness.
For I am persuaded that your steadfast love is established forever. You have set your faithfulness firmly in the heavens.
I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant.
I will establish your line forever and preserve your throne.
Happy are the people who know the festal shout. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your presence.
They rejoice daily in your name. They are jubilant in your righteousness.
For you are the glory of their strength, and by your favor our might is exalted.
Truly our shield belongs to the Lord, our King to the Holy One of Israel.
The second reading is from Romans, the 6th chapter. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient servants, as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin which leads to death or of obedience which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Seated.
Can a butterfly flapping its wings cause a hurricane? I'll let you think about that for a moment. Can a butterfly flapping its wings cause a hurricane? And it may strike us as an unusual question, especially for a Sunday morning. But perhaps it isn't such an unusual question, because it comes out of a theory that's called the butterfly effect. And I'm by no means an expert on this, but I find this fascinating. And the idea is that the simple flapping of a butterfly's wings could somehow set off a chain of events that eventually works its way up and escalates to the forming of a hurricane. This whole idea was brought up by a mathematician named Edward Lorentz. He was one of the pioneers of what is known as chaos theory. And the idea, if I understand it correctly, and you can correct me later if you're an expert, the idea is that chaos theory deals with the prediction of outcomes of massive complex systems when the beginnings, the initial condition of those systems are impossible to monitor. Take the weather, for example, which we all know is a complex system. And there are many, many factors that can affect the weather, some of which we simply can't fully take into account. Another example in the article I read dealt with traffic. A single car slamming on the brakes to avoid a squirrel could set off a chain of events that cause a major traffic jam. But predicting the movements of every single car on a busy road makes this nearly impossible to predict. So while it's difficult to know for sure whether a small action like the flapping of a butterfly's wings can cause something like a hurricane, today's gospel does tell us that God can work through our actions, even when they seem small. The three verses we just heard this morning are the last verses in the 10th chapter of Matthew. This chapter is often called the missionary discourse, because in it Jesus gives instructions to his disciples as he sends them out to do the work that he has been doing. Though it might be more accurate to say that this chapter is a mix of instructions and warnings. Because there's nothing easy about Jesus' words in this chapter. He makes it clear that there is nothing easy about being his disciple. He tells them, for example, to take nothing with them and to rely on the hospitality of others. He tells them they may not be welcome everywhere they go, and that their commitment to follow him may cause division even within their families. However, Jesus also assures his disciples that they will be given the words to speak. He assures them also that God has counted every hair on their heads and that they are of more value than many sparrows. In other words, Jesus assures them of God's presence with them, an assurance that we hear again in today's gospel. Here at the conclusion of this missionary discourse, Jesus continues to give words of reassurance to the 12 disciples. Earlier, he told them to take nothing with them. They'd have to rely on the hospitality of others as they traveled. Now, Jesus talks about those who will welcome them. Surely there will be some who welcome them, and those who do welcome them are in fact welcoming Jesus and his Heavenly Father who sent him. And then Jesus widens the scope of his instructions here by talking about others who will be sharing in this work. Jesus again includes those who will welcome the 12, but he even includes those who will give something as simple as a cup of cold water. Jesus specifically mentions giving a cup of cold water to one of these little ones. Now, the Greek here can sometimes be used to refer to children, but here in Matthew's gospel is used to describe the disciples of Jesus. These little ones are his disciples. And as Jesus sends out his 12, he is also including those who serve and support them along the way, perhaps a reminder that even small gestures matter in the kingdom of God. Because let's face it, the words from this 10th chapter of Matthew the past 2 weeks have not been easy to hear. It isn't easy to be a disciple of Jesus. It isn't easy to follow his ways or to show his love. We might wonder if we could ever possibly be a follower of Jesus. We might wonder if we could ever possibly be a part of God's work in the world. At times it sounds like it's just too much. The good news here is that even a seemingly small gesture, such as giving a cup of water, is in fact part of doing God's work in the world. And though Jesus uses the words little ones here to refer to the 12, I can't imagine limiting his words just to those 12 disciples. Elsewhere in Scripture, this word that means little ones can mean children or any who are vulnerable. And of course, to be thirsty is to be vulnerable. But so too is to be hungry or homeless. So too is to be lonely or grieving. So too is to be in a new neighborhood, state, or country. So too is to be a victim of violence or war. So too is to be estranged from loved ones. And so too is to face discrimination. And when we give even a cup of water, or a can of food, or a box of diapers, or a few dollars in an offering plate, or a shoulder to cry on, or a listening ear, or a helping hand, or a word of affirmation, or a welcoming embrace, we are following in the ways of Jesus. We are doing God's work in the world. It may not seem like much at the time, but we may never know what impact our words or actions. And though Jesus says that those who do these things will not lose their reward, we do these things not to earn something, but in response to what Jesus has done for us. It was no small thing that Jesus did for us on the cross. He gave his very life. He welcomes us now into his kingdom, regardless of what we've done or not done. And we who are loved so deeply that are invited to respond out of love towards others, we may never even know how our words or actions that seem so small might end up making a significant impact. But whether we know it or not, whether the impact is small or significant, we act out of love, trusting that God works through us. It's not about getting results. It's about sharing the love that God has shown to us. And there is the very real possibility that we too may be changed when we do. So you might be wondering, what is the answer? Can a butterfly flapping its wings cause a hurricane? The short answer is no, but in reality, it's complicated. The answer, though, is far less complicated when it comes to what may seem like our small, simple gestures. Though we may not know the outcome, we can trust that God will work through our acts of love, no matter how small. Amen. With the whole church, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. We pray for the church, for wisdom to heed the voices of prophets in our midst who cast a vision of God's promised future, for courage to welcome people whom society rejects, to resolve to serve all in need. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for creation, for rivers, lakes, oceans, and streams, especially the St. Clair River and Lake Huron, for lands experiencing scorching heat, drought, or wildfires, for fields, gardens, and orchards, for careful stewardship of all the earth's resources. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our nation, for our President Joe Biden, Governor Gretchen Whitmer, members of Congress and state legislators, for judges, juries, district attorneys, and public defenders, for military personnel, for police officers, firefighters, and EMS workers. Guide us in ways of freedom that promote the common good. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those in need, for exiles, immigrants, refugees, and those seeking asylum, for victims of harassment, torture, or abuse, for those who are ill, especially those on our prayer list and those we name before you in our hearts. For any near death and for all who grieve, God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for children, for their safety at home and in child care settings, for their flourishing at summer programs and camps, for the many people who care for them, including parents and grandparents, child care workers and teachers, coaches, counselors and mentors, pediatricians and psychologists. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for congregations and those who lead them, for newly ordained pastors, newly installed pastors, and the congregations they serve, especially Pastor George Partikas-Stipe and Spirit of Grace Church, for licensed lay ministers, especially Chris Ritter. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for all the saints and prophets who have received the free gift of God, which is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. May their lives of humble service inspire us in faith. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of that peace with one another. Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation, and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
peace. The God of peace goes with you. The body of Christ is given for you. The body of Christ is given for you. The body of Christ is given for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age. Amen.
Amen.
Serve the Lord.